And to tell you the truth, I'd never even heard of them before I went down. I didn't even know where it was, Leeds. You know, for some obscure reason, I thought it was in Wales.
My mother could probably went into that Leeds United side at the time and played at centre-half because the players round about are that good.
The target at Leeds United was to win everything. And that's how colossal a club they were.
And we could mix it. Nobody liked to play against us, that's what we wanted. We wanted people to come to Elland Road and not have a nice afternoon.
It was unbelievable coming down from Scotland and you're going into the dressing room for the first time. I mean, it's like opening up a football magazine, all household names, like people like Jack Charlton had won the World Cup. But of course, there was a huge Scottish contingent.
This is the story of Clan Leeds, a little bit of Yorkshire that for a time in the 1970s was a piece of Scotland. Gordon McQueen, Peter Lorimer, Eddie Gray, David Harvey, Joe Jordan and Billy Bremner. Legendary Scots who added the tartan touch to Don Revie's famous Leeds United. It was the summer of 73, and in the previous decade, Revie's Elland Road teams had been winners, picking up a league title and several major trophies along the way. But they were capable of losing spectacularly too. In the season ahead, this was a side with something to prove.
We had so many disappointments, so many finals. I was in 10 finals, and I won 4. And we lost the championship, the league, on goal difference on 2 occasions, and we were second on that many 10, never out the top 4 in 10 years.
Leeds United had just pulled down the curtain on a season which was, by their standards, a shocker. They had been humiliated in the cup final at Wembley by second division Sunderland, and the press had a field day with Revie and his players. The headline screamed that the manager would quit for Everton. But he had other plans.
I think it made Don think that the next season was going to be the most important because he could see his side beginning to break up, I think. You know, they were getting a little bit older. And I think he realised this: the 1974 season would have been the last chance for them to do anything big together.
All he did was he showed us the press cuttings and the recordings on television of how we were finished. You know, we were too old, Don Revie had finished, the players were too old, we were rubbish, Sunderland had beat us. And that really, really riled us on.
He pulled all the players in at the beginning of the season and says, look, we're going for the league championship this year. Forget the rest, forget the league cups and all that. I am not interested.
He said, right, lads, we're going to go through the season getting... We're not going to be beaten.
Which was unbelievable at the time. He thought, ah, no, that just can't be done. But he believed it could.
Their time had come. Leeds United, once negative and defensive, went through a makeover. Fired up by the criticism, the First Division was about to be hit by the charge of the White Brigade.
Here's Bremner!
Everton were thrashed in the opening game, and then Spurs were swept aside in a bruising 3-0 defeat.
Here's Bremner! What terrible marking by Tottenham!
Leeds were on fire, and it was Revie who was fanning the flames. Don Revie was special. He looked on Leeds United as his second family, and he knew when to be the stern father or the benevolent uncle. In return, he received a loyalty from his players, which was, even in those days, rare. He created a team bond that was the envy of the league.
When he brought a player in, I think he looked at the player, obviously about his ability to play the game, but also the character and personality of the player, that he would be a player that would mix, would settle in, and would go on with other players and vice versa.
When it was time to extend his family, Revie chose wisely. And when he discovered Eddie Gray, that meant another cross-border raid to a school on the south side of Glasgow for a chat with a reluctant headmaster.
Basically, he just says to my mother, I'm going to go up and see the headmaster. He's going to come down to Leeds, he's going to be a football player. So he went to see the headmaster, and I was standing outside the office, I'll never forget it, and he went in on his own. So I don't know what he says to the headmaster, or, you know, if he gave him anything, or, you know, I don't know. But that was it. I left school on that Monday and come down to Leeds.
Revie's family spirit was forged in the dressing room. Experience and youth side by side. Old hands who had carved out international careers were ordered to look after the kids.
When I went down, I stripped between Eddie Gray and Peter Lorimer. So that was a nice little touch where I was there. I mean, they were... a few years older than myself, but it was done for a purpose.
Well, yeah, we used to call Joe the Chuchter. He used, you know, he come down. Joe is a bit dour, you know. He's a bit of a, he's a very serious lad. Lovely lad is Joe, but he has got a serious side to him. And so, obviously, if you've got that in your makeup, you're going to be on the receiving end of more stick.
And Raw, and there was no doubt I was Raw in those days, and Norman would have you nearly polished by the end of the season, be pushing you, pulling you, telling you where to go, and of course, he was a phenomenal player himself.
Playing at Derby once, and I ran out, and the big man was behind me, laid on the floor. He shouted, "Don't leave me, Norm, don't leave." And he had cramp in both legs. He had just come down from Scotland, you know, he hadn't played many games. But he was a good sign-in, and Joe Jordan was too.
In a team of favoured sons, Billy Bremner was the golden child.
I think he certainly had a father-son relationship with Billy Bremner. I think out of all the players, that was the player that he was closest to. I don't think there's any doubt about that. And of course, he was his captain and an inspirational captain as well. You know, he had a huge influence on, obviously, on Leeds United.
When Billy Bremner took us across the white line, whether it's at Ellen Road or Anfield or Old Trafford, Stamford Bridge, those players, my team, we died for Leeds United. We died for that club. Billy was the best player I ever played with. They'll make players like him today.
Here's Bremner!
There was a stage when there was actually 17 Scots at Ellen Road, which is staggering when you hardly get any at some of the football clubs now. I mean, the English players were running around with Scottish accents at the time at Ellen Road.
For over 10 years, Don Revie was all-powerful at Leeds United. There was little interference from the board, and he was as comfortable negotiating big-money transfers as he was taking training. For the players, his brand of hands-on management proved inspiring.
Well, we do this every Thursday morning for the last 11 to 12 years. I feel it's been a great thing to them because it just relaxes them a little bit and gets the tension out of the muscles before the Saturday match.
To have a top manager getting absolutely soaked on a Thursday, rubbing everybody down. They used to massage you along with Sid Owen, along with Bob English and Les Cocker, and they used to massage you top and tail, turnover, exactly the same. Then you had your kind of plunge. And that's what we were used to.
His talent certainly rubbed off on the team. Unlike today's superannuated stars, the Leeds players were happy to pick up their pay in a poke.
We used to get paid weekly, but we used to get a brown envelope and we'd pay in cash.
Oh, I don't know.
Did you take that one this week?
Change.
He'd say, when you're picking your wages up, don't forget to go on the players' lounge to sign those footballs that, like, youth clubs had sent in, parents. And every Thursday, when we were to pick up our wages, we must have signed between 50 and 100 footballs.
It's a cliche, but I think every player you talk to about Legion, about Don Revie, any ex-Leeds United player, I tell you, they'd run through a brick wall for him. And I think that's the way every player felt about him.
All right, big man.
Hi.
Hi. You're not putting the backs of your legs or anything, are you?
No.
Or you said you were a little bit. Are you groined or anything?
Not bad, no.
I remember once and I woke up one morning, well, I was struggling all week and I had ankles about that thick, couldn't see an ankle bone or nothing. And my missus said, "What are you going to do?" I said, "Oh, I'm going down for a fitness test." She said, "You crackers." I said, "I'm going down, don't worry. I'll be back." But then I got down there and he puts his arm round you and he said, "Come on, I'd rather have a three-quarter you fit than anybody else, all the usual, you know. Go on, try it for me, son." And you'd hobble up there and you'd say, "It's not too... Go on, try that tackle, son. Les, what do you think? I'd be all right. Get a strapping on. Out you go."
I'm going to do some things and put yourself out for Saturday. I've got the Easter programme coming on. This should be professional.
Oh, yeah, he was very clever. I mean, being a good manager, you've got to be good at man management, and that's what he was good at. When you think back on it, he's a bit of a con man, really, the way he kidded you all and that, but it was all done for the good of the team.
He had a great drive that season, and, you know, he was pushing the players and pushing them, and he wanted them to go and You know, like, they went on an unbelievable run, you know, and he wanted to maintain that.
As 1973 drew to a close, Revy convinced his players they could win the league unbeaten. At the beginning of December, Leeds faced Ipswich. They were 8 points clear in the league and on the brink of equaling main rival Liverpool's record of 20 games without defeat. By now, United were a team on a mission.
Beatty underneath, not a good header, straight to Yoris. And he scored, Terry Yoris. What a disaster for Ipswich.
We never changed our formation. Why should we change our formation? We'll let them worry about us.
Jones. And another.
Systems do not win football matches. Football players win football matches. But you play to a pattern, which we did. We play a 4-4-2. Pete Lorimer on the right wing, Eddie Gray on the left. Mick Jones and out front. And we never changed that pattern.
Clark. Rooney just inside. Yoris on the far post. Clark going in alone.
Leeds were on course to beat Liverpool's unbeaten record. And every team in the league was out to spoil the party. Chelsea were notoriously fierce rivals. In the FA Cup final of 1970, both teams had gone to war in what was described as the dirtiest game of football ever played. The next game of the season would be against their bitter rivals.
Every game between those two clubs was a physical battle. So we had to go there, and obviously Chelsea are looking for a scalp to stop Leeds going through and completing that season undefeated.
By now, Leeds had fallen into a beautiful rhythmic style, and it was really just a matter of when the goal would come. It was Jones' 11th league goal of the season, and one he won't forget.
The Leeds team battled hard to beat the record and win over the critics who'd accused them of being more physical than skillful. But reputations are hard to shake, and Leeds were still an intimidating outfit.
I used to look at some of the games Leeds United play and I'd wince. I'd think, jeez, it's a bit brutal, this game, you know. Wasn't the game I came here to play.
The first tackle you ever had was nearly always free. The first one was a freebie. So Don Revy used to say it to me, Norman, just let them know you're there. And I didn't disappoint many people. So as it was knocked up to them, just get close to them. Just hit them a bit. And if they pick themselves up and come back at you, then you knew you had a hard afternoon. But if they laid down and didn't come back, then it made your afternoon very, very easy.
There was lots of teams around who, you know, one or two of the southern teams, you know, when, by the time the bus came over the Trent at Nottingham, they were beat because they didn't want to come up north because they thought, woof, we'll get it today at Leeds in a muddy pitch and they'll come out and they'll steam into us. And that's how we did it, yeah. We didn't disappoint them, you know. We'd come out first 10 minutes, hit them with everything, and they were beat. You know, you could see the, you know, they just didn't want to be there. They were good memories, actually.
A lot of people give a stick about how hard we were. We used to fight for that ball simply because we were brought up as winners.
In all fairness, we were unpopular because we were the best. And I think when you were the best, people don't like you.
We got a reputation and we deserved it. You know, looking back, we did things. I did things personally that I wasn't proud of and that I look back at. But you did it to win.
And then there was the in-house tribal warfare. Did you hear the one about the Englishman, the Irishman, the Welshman and the Scots? For Don Revy, it was no laughing matter.
Any more in the book on a Saturday doing that?
We used to play Scotland against England, five-a-side matches. But it was like World War III. I mean, it was like some of them getting rather nasty.
And at Ellen Road at that time, we used to have 2,000 or 3,000 people down watching us training at the back of the main stand there every day. And the competition between the Scots and the English in five-a-side, you would not believe. You would not believe. It was worth the entrance money to come in through the week to watch it. And I've seen many a scuffle between Norman and Peter and, you know, and Eddie and Jack.
No! Time up! No! Hit the post!
Used to have to stop them because all of a sudden you're mates and you've got a game and it's Thursday or something and you're playing on Saturday And then all of a sudden, it was tackles flying in.
Rev used to have to break us up, the Scots and the English, many a time. He used to have to come on, lads, let's get in the bath. And you still used to be arguing and shouting and going off the pitch. And that's what the competition was like. But good, healthy competition.
And the two teams are coming out on the field.
But there were times when even the great Don Revie couldn't tame that competitive edge. No more so than when his players stood on opposing sides in the annual home internationals.
We played England, and it was just before we had a big European match, and the gaffer said to Norman, you know, I don't want you hammering into Billy or Peter any stupid tackles, but when you got out there, first tackle, I think Billy went straight in the air, and who'd done it? It was Norman, because you just couldn't help it.
Bremner. And the referee has got to go and have a word with Norman Hunter about that.
We're playing in that game up at Hampden, and I think it was little Asa Hartford played for Scotland, and Asa had a go at me and he caught me, and little Billy's the midfielder, and I'm, you know, the blood, I got a bit of a red mist, and I went into one tackle and I won that, and the ball went away from me, and I'm stumbling a little bit, and then I go into the next tackle and the ball breaks away, and I'm stumbling a bit more, and I see these socks and shorts coming, and I think it's Asa. And I went, bang, and I hit him, and I really copped him a beauty. And when it all turned out, it was little Billy Bremner. I had absolutely buried him, absolutely. And he's laid there, he's calling me all the English names under the sun. And for 20 minutes after that game, he chased me round Hampden. And Don Revie, we went out to see him after the game, and he stood there and he said to me, "You? Kicking little Billy and little Billy's sin. Go on, tell him, gaffer."
United eventually silenced the critics who'd accused them of being dirty. But it wasn't just the carping journalists whose numbers were up.
To relieve the boredom, Don used to like to play little games, carpet bowls, bingo. And the carpet bowls got serious. You know, that was, you had a partner at the carpet bowls. You used to play pairs. And Peter Lorimer and I, we were the bookmakers, you know, and we used to run the book on it. Sometimes we won, sometimes we lost. But it was serious stuff. And then the bingo.
7 and 1, 71. 1 and 2, 12. 2 and 5, 25. 4 and 3, 43.
It was a laugh and a joke. The ritual was, if you won a hand at bingo, you went up and you had to shout the numbers. So if you were a young member, went up and you had to go up, and especially when you had a Scottish voice, and you're trying to say 22 or 90 and give it all clickety-click, they would slaughter you. Absolutely. So it broke the tension.
It would drag a long night into a short night because you'd play your balls and your bingo, then it'd be bedtime, so you'd be ready for the game the next morning. But, yeah, people used to laugh, oh, they play bingo and they do this. But it was, yeah, when you think about it, I couldn't see the modern-day professionals sitting playing bingo for a put a fiver in each or whatever, but we did and we enjoyed it, and it certainly didn't do us any harm.
Its own, number 5, all the sixes, 66, 5 and 6.
The most feared team in European football liked to unwind dreaming of two fat ladies, but they never lost sight of Revie's number one target. He didn't want a full house, just the championship. In the UEFA Cup, Hibs held Leeds to a draw at Elland Road. For the return leg in Edinburgh, Don Revie had a surprise. Not just for Hibs, but for the Leeds players whose will to win was ingrained.
He said to me, Billy and Eddie, look, you know, you're going up there, but I don't want you getting injured. Your parents should come and see you. I don't want any bad tackles. Keep out of trouble. We'll go up there. And we weren't not trying, but we were just playing the kids, you know. And we just went up there really for to see our parents, enjoy the game. And Hibs had been down here and drew, you know, he said that they're not a bad side, you know, so he would have been happy that we went out.
He just rested so many players. It was more or less put out a reserve side. But Billy wanted to play, going back to Scotland, playing against Hibs, and you know he was brought up not that far away from Edinburgh and Stirling, and Billy played sweeper and was absolutely unbelievable, gave an astonishing performance, and they get through to the next round. But it's one of the few occasions like Don Revie didn't really want to win the game, but Billy had different ideas.
Leeds eventually went out of the UEFA Cup to Vitória Setúbal and took an early exit in the FA Cup with a shock defeat to Bristol City on the 19th of February 1974.
Leeds defence absolutely wide open.
Now there were no distractions. Leeds were free to chase the dream of winning the league undefeated. At home to Stoke City, they were looking to stretch their unbeaten run to 30 games.
We had a couple of little hairy moments, you know, going to Newcastle, winning 1-0. We went to Birmingham, and I think we drew at Birmingham. But then we went to Stoke. Stoke was the place. And we were 2-0 up. How we lost it, I'll never know.
But lose they did. It was a shock 3-2 victory for Stoke.
If we weren't playing that well, he'd come into the dressing room and we could tell if he was upset, because the first thing he would do, he'd go to the mirror and comb his hair, and then he'd wipe everything off the table. And he would let you know, in no uncertain terms, that he wasn't happy.
On that day, he was combing his hair and Les Cocker was beside him, and it was, whether he allowed it to be overhead or not, he's saying to Les as he was combing his hair and trying to compose himself, he says, "Les, I think it's about time we got some players in here. I think we need to get the chequebook out."
Oh, he went mad, he was crazy, and we were all well clear at the top of the league. What's up with him?
Come on!
Don Revie's team had gone a record 29 games undefeated. A cause for celebration, you might think. But bizarrely, in that one defeat, Revie seemed to see 10 years of hard work begin to unravel. The spell he had cast over the team, broken. His anxiety filtered through to his players, and a string of bad results followed. At times of crisis, Revie put his faith not so much in his team, but in a set of otherworldly rituals. It wasn't a rabbit's foot or a horseshoe the doubt-ridden manager turned to for inspiration. It was his lucky traffic light.
I'm possibly the most superstitious man in the world. Every year I have a light blue Moyer suit made, and I wear it all season for matches. I usually put the same shirt on, the same socks, the same shoes.
I remember having a team meeting at Roundy Park, and these trousers were shiny at the back because he'd been worn that much. And he had these notes, and he was reading these notes, and he dropped them on the floor. And he bent down, and all of a sudden we heard this... He'd ripped all his trousers at the back. Well, this sudden panic on his face. And he said to one of the staff, he said, "Get them down to the ground, get them fixed before 3 o'clock, and really in panic, put some tracksuit bottoms on." He went down to the ground, and half past two, the trousers hadn't come back. And the panic on his face was immense. 2:50, still hadn't come. And he shouted in the corridor, I'll not use the language, but what he said, I wouldn't say I'll repeat it. And at 2:55, they came in, these trousers, and he put them on, and the relief on his face was incredible.
I think superstitions only work if you've got good players. At Leeds United, they always just sit in the same seats in the coach, and they just sit in the same seats in the dining room and in hotels, and we used to go through the same ritual, and certain players go out in certain positions, and certain players carry balls out, and certain players put the left boots on first.
Obviously, as the years went on, he built up more and more superstitions, because the way he was, if something happened good and he'd done something, that was included in the next lot of superstitions. So by the time it got to the end of his managing at Leeds, he had that many superstitions, it must have took him an hour every day to go through them all.
And then he had a gypsy coming down to the ground once to try and get rid of a curse he thought was on Ellen Road. I don't know why he thought that was a curse on Ellen Road, because hardly him to beat us there. I know. But he got the gypsy to come down.
He was a warrior, you know, and there was always a little bit of a doubt in his mind about what his team could achieve and what they couldn't achieve, you know, and sometimes maybe that transmitted through to the players.
Revie might have been dressed to kill, but Liverpool refused to die. They were closing in on the league leaders as a faltering Leeds, unsettled by their manager's doubts, strung together a run of draws after the Stoke defeat. All of which meant, to all intents and purposes, the clash of the clubs looked like a championship decider. It was an occasion tailor-made for the lucky suit.
That was the game, you know, in those days. The Liverpool game was always the game that everybody looked forward to. They would look forward to it, we would look forward to it. And you'd realise that, you know, it was going to be a right scrap. They knew if they could put one over on us, they'd have a fair chance of winning a league championship.
Suddenly those faces altogether different.
No doubt aided by Revy's host of lucky charms, Leeds recovered. By the 20th of April, Don Revy and his players were again within touching distance of the title. If Liverpool dropped a point against Arsenal, then it was all over.
When the phone call came through from Anfield that Arsenal had beaten Liverpool 1-0 and Leeds United had won the championship, there was only Kimmy and I here. Elsie was away playing golf in Sheffield. And Kim and I just sat down and cried.
And so Leeds went into the closing game of the season already champions. But there was the small matter of standing ovations and celebrations.
As a young lad coming from Scotland, I just thought this is the way it's going to be every year, year after year after year. And I was to find out not so long afterwards, and wait a minute, this team is a bit unique and this just doesn't really happen that often.
Don Revy's Leeds career had spanned 16 years. The squad, his family had built from scratch, had matured into one of the finest football teams in Europe. He had joined as a player in 1958, became manager in 1961 with Leeds in Division 2, and left them as league champions in 74. Because when the England job was offered, the great man knew his time had come.
Very, very sad. Because when you get attached to a club like I've got attached to this one, and built the family atmosphere, you get very attached, but... yes, it'd be a sad day.
I think it would have been a bigger shock for the younger players, you know, the boys that were 15, 16, 17, because he was still that father figure to them, you know. But it was a big disappointment. I think it would have been a bigger disappointment if Don Revy would have left and went to another club.
It was good and sad, because it was good that we'd won it, and it was sad because it was, one, Don was leaving, two, one or two of the lads knew they were going to be going. I don't think he wanted to be involved with telling Billy and telling Johnny and telling Norman that it was time to go. You know, I think he thought, I'll let somebody else do that. Probably people would think, well, it's a cowardly way out. No, I don't think so. I think that was probably respect for them, that he didn't want to be the one.
Funny game football. At the season's opening, outspoken Derby County manager Brian Clough had called for Leeds to be relegated. Less than a year later, he became their new boss.
Don Revy and Brian Clough, as everybody knows, didn't get on well together. Brian Clough didn't particularly like Leeds United as players, didn't like the club as such, and then all of a sudden he's there and is your manager.
And basically, he told everybody what he thought about Don, and that wasn't a lot. He told him what he thought about the players, and that was nothing. So he came in the wrong foot, and it just never worked for him.
Clough's reign lasted just 44 days. With Don Revy gone, his team broke up. Joe Jordan and Gordon McQueen would eventually leave for Manchester United, Norman Hunter to Bristol City, and Billy Bremner to Hull. Things would never be the same again at Elland Road.
But I still think that team broke up a little bit too early. I still think they could have played for another few seasons ago.
I didn't realise until I left Leeds that there were bad footballers out there, you know, people that were useless, really, compared to what I'd been playing with.
It just happened in that year that everything flowed. We were physical, we didn't want to lose, we were great players, we had a great side, and we had a great 74.